other spouse who's not the owner gets a right to the value of it. They don't actually get to own it, so they can't just take the couch and live with it. At the end of the marriage, they can take half of the value with them, which would be decided upon within the couple. So that's how that works.
Okay, so an unmarried couple with a child separates after a few years. Though the residence is owned by the man, the woman still has the right to live in the residence with their child. True or false?
True.
True.
False? Okay, so it kind of depends. So if the mom has the custody of the child, the court can declare that she has a right to stay in that family home, even though she's not the owner of the house. And these people are not married. Okay, a spouse can divorce his partner because of her drug addiction. True? False? So it's true, because a drug addiction can be compared as a mental abuse. So it can fall in the category for a divorce.
So in the process of divorce, there's this thing called mediation. So is it mandatory before a couple can get divorced? True? False. You guys are right. However, the information session is obligatory. So the mediation isn't, but the information session about mediation, both spouses have to go in order to be seen by the court. So child support is always paid by the ex-spouse with the higher salary.
True
or false?
True?
False? So it's actually very relative to the child custody. And so whoever has the kid, that would determine. So even if I make more, but I have the kid more of the time, the person who's making less money can actually be forced to pay me child support. So now we'll get into the marriage, the rights and the obligations.
Okay, so after the quiz, you can kind of see that we're not too familiar with the family law. So we're gonna go step by step and we're going to start by looking at the different regimes you can find in a household. So first off, we have the de facto union. So a de facto union is basically two people living together, not married. So it's just a couple, a relationship. You don't need to have a child, they can have a child, but they can't simply be two roommates. So they have to have a common life goal and they have to represent themselves as a couple. So this regime is not legally recognized in Quebec, so it doesn't create any legal obligations or any legal rights. That's the principle. It doesn't create any legal stuff. So the rule is that basically each spouse remains the owner of the goods that they acquired prior and during their relationship. But there are some exceptions to those to that principle. So we're going to see a bit of those exceptions. So first off, if each spouse, they buy a house together in the relationship, after the relationship, once they separate, one of the spouse can force the other one to proceed in the selling of that house. So they can force the other spouse to sell the home because no one is bound to remain in division. So they have that right to force the other one to sell the house. Another one is like in the quiz that we saw. So if one of the spouses gets the custody of the child, the court can give the right to one of the spouses to keep on living in that household, even though they're not the owner of the house. And we also have what is called the unjust enrichment. So this, basically when you're in a de facto union and you separate, you don't have the right to have financial support from the other spouse. So I'll give you an example. So if you have one person who works and you have the other person who stays at home, takes care of the kids, cleans the house, does all that work at home, and then you have the other one who both works outside, and then once you separate, well, basically the person who stayed at home would be left with nothing, right? Because he went to work, but he would have worked on the house, on the family. So it would have a really big disproportion of the goods. So this is why the our legal system came and invented this legal instrument that they call the unjust enrichment. So they basically took certain principles from an undeclared partnership and applied it to a family. So they looked at the family kind of like as a business. And they asked themselves, they said, if the person who stayed at home didn't do all the work that they did, would we have had to pay someone to do that work? And did that person enrich our family? And if yes, then that person is allowed for a compensation of some money that the other spouse has to give that person because they did contribute to the enrichment of the family. So this, we had a case that recently went to the Supreme Court. It's called the Lola case. So it's a de facto spouse from Quebec who asked the court to declare a financial support for herself after separation. And basically she was saying that it was unfair that married couples had that right, but de facto union couples did not have that right. And it's important to note that in Ontario, when you are a common law union, which you compare to a de facto union, after 3 years of being together, you do have that right of support. But in Quebec, there's no such thing. So this is why this person was wanted to come and claim her rights, but the court came and said, no, it doesn't work like that. You can't force someone the obligations of marriage. It would go against the fundamental rights of liberty to choose or not to get married. But the court went in different places and invented the unjust enrichment to solve that problem. So that's interesting to know. As well, when you're in a de facto union, you can also write contracts. So you can write contracts about obligations that you want the other spouse to respect, etc. But we very much rarely see that because people don't
foresee their separation.
Yeah, they don't plan their separation when you're in a relationship.
That's a question.
Yes.
So what happens if you are in a common law relationship in Ontario and then you move to Quebec? Common law leave?
Yes.
And so that's all like out the window now?
Okay. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, this case happens basically to have this financial support after separation. First step is you need to look, is there going to be a disproportion in the goods? Right?
Yeah, 100%. But so basically, like once you come over to Quebec, I can't give you for sure answer, but I'm pretty sure after 1 year, then your common law thing that you had in Ontario stops, because in order for you to claim a residency in a different province, it takes up to 1 year, I believe. And so in that situation, you have 1 year to save your common law marriage. But yeah, once you get to Quebec after that 1 year is up, you're now a de facto, you have no rights in terms of legally like marriage.
Yeah. And the opposite is true as well. If you move to Ontario, after 3 years, then you get those rights. But once again, there has to be this portion. So it's not automatic, oh, I get a financial amount. We have a $10,000 difference between our salaries. It's not automatic, but yes.
The judge would have to evaluate the circumstance for sure.
Yes.
I'm wondering, the Quebec situation seems to be a bit more than disadvantageous for women. And I'm wondering,
marriage contracts were exactly like a de facto union. The man walked away with what he had to his name, the woman walked away with what she had to her name, and that was it. But they realized it was discriminatory against the woman because most of the time it was her at home making an enrichment of the patrimony because she was staying home with the kids, so you didn't have to take child care. She was doing all the cleaning and all this. So that's why they made the marriage situation with the family patrimony. So in Quebec, we believe that your liberty to get married is extremely important, but your liberty to choose not to get married is also extremely. So the women, so Quebec takes for granted, I guess, the fact that women should be aware that when they get into a marriage, their rights will be protected. And if they decide not to, they have to understand the fact that they don't get any rights. The whole point that most people get married is out of love and stuff like that, but it also comes with a huge financial
there are two aspects to this. One is that the situation is to the woman's disadvantage. The other is that very many couples in Quebec
are now defacted.
Are defacted.
So that's why they implemented unjust enrichment. That's why Lola came so that they can try and address that issue. And so the person, the woman in the de facto union would have to take a recourse in unjustified enrichment in order to get their alimony payment. But it wouldn't be considered an alimony payment, it would be considered more of a compensation for the work that she provided over the years. It's problematic, I agree 100%, but that's basically where Quebec sat in their legal
advantage. And there's no effort being made by the union.
As far as I'm concerned, I'm not quite sure. I don't think so, though. I think because it was ruled by the Supreme Court, which is in Ottawa, and they decided that in Quebec makes it very clear that if you want to be protected by matrimonial regimes, you have to get married. Because it's the liberty of contracting, right? It doesn't bind yourself to a contract. So that's how they justify it.
Back to the union where you both own the house, my situation anyways, she doesn't want to sell because she knows she's not going to get very much money, but she's holding out to get more money out of me because it's pretty much just a debt.
So, and you can't answer like specific questions, but like she had said before,
marriage, civil union is the same thing. The only difference is that the civil union, it takes 18 years old and the marriage is 16 years old. And why do we have two regimes?
What, you can get married when you're 16?
Yeah, it's 16 years old to get married.
And that's the federal legislation, that's not just Quebec.
Yes, kind of. But so the difference between, so are the ages, but they basically do the same effects, the same regime, and you might ask why do we have two different regimes? Well, it's because before 2005, spouses with the same sex couldn't get married. So they invented the civil union. And now since 2005, there's no problem. People of the same sex can get married. So the civil union is a bit less popular today. So obviously we have conditions to get married. So you have to respect certain conditions. Like you said, age is 16 years old. And it has to be exclusive. So you can only be married one person. So if you're already married, you can't marry someone else, obviously. And your consent, well, it has to be free and unlike.
So. A civil union is that when you're like, I don't know, married by your buddy who took a little course online and now is that, like, I don't understand, I guess, what a civil union is.
So civil union.
Is that an actual ceremony thing?
Yeah.
So it is. Okay,
yeah.
So that's it.
It's basically the same thing as a marriage, it's just that this is more done by the state.
Right.
So,
okay. So representative of the population.
Exactly. Yeah. So it was just so that the gay couple or the same-sex couple can have an opportunity to express their life together. So some of the effects of marriage, as I said, is the family patrimony. And so basically this was created, like I said, in 1989. And it was done to protect women who were disadvantaged because men would just walk away and they'd be left with nothing, no work experience, no nothing. So what they added into the family estate is basically your family residencies, your family vehicles, the pension, as well as whatever furniture is used by the family in that family residency. So let's say you have an office at home that you use exclusively for work and you have a really important piece of furniture in there. If it's only used for you in your workspace, even if it's in the house, it's out of the family patrimony, it's not included. But if you have a BMW and you go for errands, you go do groceries with your family in it, that's included in the family patrimony. Also, the pension that's accumulated in the family patrimony starts from the day you get married to the day that you start the instance of the divorce. And so that's something you consider. Also, what's excluded of the family patrimony would be something that you inherited. If you inherit money and then you use that money like for a renovation for the house or something like that, it'd be important to document it because you have to prove that you use that money that was inherited to be excluded from the family patrimony. Let's say you inherited a car or something like that, then that's obviously easier to prove. Other things are gifts, like I said, the china plates. If you got a gift for your birthday, that's a piece of furniture, like a couch. Those are also planned. That's form of gift. Literally, even the family residency, if you were to inherit that or you got it as a gift, it would be excluded on as well. And then, yeah, or donations.
If you inherit a house.
Yes. What about that house? It's a very nice inheritance.
If you inherit a house with your siblings, but you and your spouse buy out the sibling shares, but it wasn't noted that how much each person owed, can they come back on you on that, or?
So the amount that you inherited,
mm-hmm.
So the person who inherits, their portion is outside of the family patrimony. Whatever was bought during the marriage with the spouse that's not part of the inheritance, that would have to be part of the family patrimony. So it would basically, there would be a portion that would have to be made,
okay,
of what was considered an inheritance and what was considered not, and that was bought out, basically. So that portion would be excluded. So, yeah. Another thing is the responsibility. So there's fidelity, respect, and assistance. Respect would be like you can't go around bullying your spouse. I think that's pretty clear. You can't constantly tell them the facts and stuff like that. That's considered psychological abuse. There's also fidelity, which is actually one of the reasons that you can get divorced, as you guys will see later. It's one of the effects that you can invoke. And then there's assistance. And so there's not only financial assistance, but also moral assistance. Yes, do you have a question? No, period. And so the financial support is basically within your means. And so let's say there's one spouse that's making $40,000, the other one's making $100,000. Even though they're disproportionate, they're still considered contributing to the financial situation of the family unit. However, moral support is supposed to be proportionate. It's supposed to be equal. So they're both supposed to contribute to the chores, to the emotional availability for their kids, any family responsibilities outside to help the parents and stuff like that. It's supposed to be engaged equally. And so those are things that actually will eventually live on even after the separation, more particularly the financial support. And so also there is mandates when you're married. Like for instance, if your kids have to go on an outing, one parent can sign and it's considered valid. Or if there's a leak in the house and the wife calls the plumber but then she doesn't pay, so then the plumber can actually go after the husband. So you basically mandate each other in the tasks that are relative to your family residence. And then also while you're married, let's say the wife owns the house, she can't sell it if it's the family residency without consulting her spouse and vice versa, if it's the man that owns the house. And also the furniture inside the goods. And so that's one of it's called a protection, like a measurement protection. And it's only valid during the marriage.